I'm Dooley Kiefer. I've lived in Ithaca for more than 50 years. I went to Cornell and never left. I've been on the county legislature for 20 years. I'm running for re-election. I should say that up front. But that's not the reason I'm talking on your local radio station.
Yeah, and so recently the New York State Senator Mike Nozzolio has come out with other local leaders from Lansing calling on the New York State Public Service Commission to repower the Cayuga operating plant. And what they say is that if the plant is not repowered, the annual tax burden on the average Lansing property taxpayer will increase by about $600. And so they're saying that pretty much this press release on Mike Nozzolio's webpage is pretty much focusing mostly on this tax increase argument for not closing the plant and repowering it with natural gas. And I wanted to know what you thought about that.
Sure. Well, I think Mike Nozzolio is doing a good job of representing what he thinks his constituents want. But with respect to repowering Cayuga with natural gas, I think that's the wrong decision. If you read all the submissions in the case, you will not be surprised that the Cayuga station, which used to be called Milliken Station, most of us know it that way, has been a reasonably reliable coal plant, but coal as a fuel has been recognized to be not a good match if you want to have decreased greenhouse gas emissions. Coal is a dirty fuel. It's dirty to mine, and it's dirty to burn. So I can understand wanting to change from coal. However, natural gas has its own problems. It emits more methane than CO2. Methane is a more powerful greenhouse gas in the near term than CO2. And I think it's a mistake to repower with natural gas. I think it's a mistake because many plants nationwide are jumping on the natural gas bandwagon. It's very appealing, with hydrofracking making natural gas more readily available in areas where it hadn't been. But hydrofracking also has its environmental problems. And because so many places now want natural gas, I doubt that the price is going to stay low and attractive. I think it can only go up. And I think locking oneself into a fuel that's going to become more expensive is a mistake. So for environmental and economic reasons, I think it's a mistake to repower with natural gas. There is an alternative. The PSC has a proposal from New York State Electric and Gas to upgrade a transmission line. I know we live in an area which is a load pocket. It's kind of a backwater for electricity. There is a reliability problem when demand is high in this area. And so having better transmission lines are going to be needed in any event. NYSEG does a good job of putting forth an analysis that says it will be cheaper to upgrade transmission lines, which are needed anyway, than to repower with natural gas. The problem for me and for any other member of the public, when you look at the submissions under the PSC case, the relevant PSC cases, is that a lot of the submissions are redacted. We cannot see the economic analysis. So we have to just take sort of at face value what the parties to the case are saying in terms of economics. So you said something about taxes for Lansing.
Yeah, so
and
basically
I'm sure that's true. I think taxes would go up if the Cayuga station, as it's called now, closes.
Yeah, they're saying the average taxpayer would have to pay $600 more in I guess property taxes.
Well, That may or may not be true, but I must point out, as they don't, that residents of Lansing and the Lansing School District have enjoyed decades of low taxes as opposed to most other school districts in our county and most other property owners because of the existence of this very valuable ratepayer in Lansing. So they have gotten a tremendous benefit over decades, and they should not be surprised by the decreased value of Cayuga Station as a coal plant. In fact, there's been a pilot agreement in place. Instead of having the plant assessed the way most industrial facilities are assessed by our county assessment department, our industrial development agency entered into a pilot agreement with the Cayuga Station owners. It was AES Cayuga at that time. And the handwriting was on the wall. It was clear that the station was becoming less and less valuable because it was powered by coal. And so the value of the plant was set to decrease each year over a period of probably 5 years. So the Lansing School District knew this was coming, and so did the town. And the Lansing School District has adjusted its budget for this, what our county administrator calls a glide path down in value. It's much better not to drop value hugely in 1 year, but to, over a period of years, do it more gradually so that the affected people have time to adjust. And that's what's been going on with Cayuga Plant for several years now. So it should not come as a surprise to the Lansing schools or Lansing taxpayers. I can understand that businesses in general and Lansing politicians definitely would say the plant should be repowered with gas because that would make their constituents happy. But I really think this whole case should not be about tax base and taxes. It's about the future of New York State's energy plan. And I view climate change as an existential threat. And I think we have got to convert to renewables. I think it's a mistake to repower with natural gas. So I can talk more about that, but I think that's all you asked me.
Yeah, and so kind of thinking about, if they were to repower the plant, and we do see increasing support and awareness about the potential for renewables, do you see that the increasing popularity of renewables would further decrease the value of that plant and then, decrease the kind of the profitability in terms of taxes of this plant, and then kind of on the other side, if there are some people who say that Lansing should do some sort of renewables plan, would they be able to make up that? Is there any plan on the table where they'd be able to make up some of that lost revenue with some sort of renewables plan to kind of
Okay.
appease both sides, appease the taxes issue and appease the environmental concerns? I don't know if there's anything that's been on the table in that way. I'm not sure.
The Public Service Commission cases that involve this plant are limited in what the supposed options are. The PSC has said there are four repowering options with natural gas, or there is a transmission upgrade. So they propose it as an either-or, and I think that's very unfortunate. I think, oh, and I should say that of the four repowering options with natural gas, every one of them includes the addition of a 2 MW solar array on the site. So that is taxable. That's a ratable. And so I think it would be correct, no matter what decision is made, to have that 2 MW solar array put on site. However, there are other ways to deal with the reliability problem and the capacity problem a capacity shortfall, supposed capacity shortfall. New York State has sufficient capacity as a state. The question is, can the generation reach our area? And that's where the transmission line upgrade is very important. So having a 2-megawatt solar array and a transmission line upgrade is sort of basic. I think those things should both happen. With respect to other renewables, I have been at a meeting where one person said, why not do pumped storage on that site, create a large lake at the top of the hill, and when electric rates are cheap at night, pump the water from the lake up there, and during the day when rates are higher, when electricity is more in demand, you let the pumped storage flow back into the lake, and that is like a hydro plant generating electricity. So that's another option. I've heard other people suggest that, and this is, I think it's the Sierra Club who is also a party in the case, they have suggested that it's possible to take energy savings more seriously, to make sure that people insulate homes, make sure people have electrically efficient equipment in their homes, which means they need less megawatts to run their equipment. So by having partial renewables, by having greater energy efficiency, you can reduce the need for the 300 megawatts of capacity that Cayuga Station presently provides. So I think there are more options that are being considered under this present Public Service Commission case. And I hope when residents go to the January 29th Public Service Commission hearing, they point out that we have more options that are on the table right now, and the case should be expanded to include those.
Talking about, there's kind of another thing that they're talking about in Senator Nozzolio's website about kind of the jobs aspect, and this is kind of something you hear a lot, where, you know, they'll say whatever the kind of gas development it is, that it will create jobs. They say there'll be quality jobs, and even they have in this press release, they have representatives from the local 83 International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers and the Tompkins Cortland Building and Construction Trades Council, you know, coming out in support of this. And, you know, do you have a response to the thoughts about what kind of jobs
I have never known of a construction project that wasn't supported by construction unions. It's just part of their livelihood. So, of course, any people involved in construction would want this to go forward because it will be jobs, temporary jobs for them, but they'll be good jobs. With respect to the plant itself, it doesn't take that many people to run the plant. They've already let a number of people go. It's been way downsized. And if it were to continue in operation, there would be some small number of jobs. But I don't count construction jobs. I think they're important, but they're not long-term. And if there is some kind of renewable use on that site, those would also be jobs. I don't think that, as I said, that this should be viewed as jobs and taxes as being the most important things. We have to really worry about New York State's energy future. And to the extent that you have retrofits of homes with insulation, and you have distributed energy in terms of individual solar arrays on residential property or commercial property, to the extent that you do these other things, all of those create jobs too. So it's an argument, but I don't think it should be the swing vote by any means.
Mm-hmm. So basically between the two, they're a bit, it's kind of the, it's only really this that they mention. They say it's the taxes and they say it's the jobs.
They don't care how the energy is produced.
And so I'm not really sh they don't really s explain anything about why I guess why you couldn't have the same or even more jobs doing something in renewables, and why you couldn't also tax that revenue from a renewables plan. So I mean, can you
They
maybe
don't.
explain to the our listeners why this the way it's being presented is or is not a false choice?
I tried to do that. I think you just said it very well. Any development will require some jobs, and there's no reason to think that these traditional jobs are the answer to everything. I think our economy has to change. If we're going to survive climate change, we're going to have to focus on other things. And I'm really sorry to see that our Chamber of Commerce is not that forward-looking. I'm not at all critical of the construction unions because they always support construction jobs. That's understandable. I'm disappointed in a leader like Senator Nozzolio for not looking at the bigger picture.
And so, you're a member of the Tompkins County Legislature, but it doesn't appear that the legislature has a real has a lot of skin in the game. I guess it's really up to the Public Service Commission. Is that right?
Well, it's the Public Service Commission that will decide, yes. The Tompkins County Legislature certainly is interested in this, but I'm not sure if it's really appropriate for us to, as a legislature, take a position. I think individual legislators will. I think that some of our advisory groups, like our Environmental Management Council, might take a position because a group like that understands the big picture, but I'm not surprised that the legislature hasn't tried to focus on this. You may or may not be familiar with how the legislature works. We have committees which work on issues and then make recommendations to the legislature, which usually takes a matter of weeks, and then the legislature may vote on a position statement, pass a resolution. So in order to get something done by January 20, by January, July 29th is virtually impossible for our legislature. It just is not the schedule on which we meet that we could do that.
And do you have any idea when they're planning to make this decision of
The
whether,
PSC?
yeah.
By the end of the year is all they've said. So I think there's plenty of time to put in comments, but it's rare to have an actual opportunity to put in public comments. So this January 29th appearance of the PSC locally will be very important.
And can you speak to when people are going to make public comments, what kind of things are most important for people to say when they're making these public comments? There's some sometimes a public comment session can turn into something that's very confusing. And so I mean you've seen a lot of these things. You might be able to speak about that maybe.
Well, I think that it's a wonderful opportunity to be sure that at least one member of the Public Service Commission will hear what you're saying. But to the extent that you're just saying, we think it should be this because of jobs, or we think it should be this because of taxes, is not going to shed any light. It will convey public sentiment, but it won't help them make a decision. To the extent that you can bring some analytical information to them it may be of more use. I can't tell you what to say, but I think that hearing many people say the same thing, which is what often happens at these hearings, is not surprising, but I don't think it necessarily helps them see what is best for the state. And so to the extent that you can bring some analytical intelligence to bear, I think that's useful.
Yeah. We live in a community where we have a lot of very intelligent people. I'm hoping that will get us somewhere. And so I guess, just kind of finishing up, I mean, it seems fairly clear that the way the discussion is being framed is, it's a false dilemma. We're given two choices, or seemingly two choices, but isn't really the whole story, and I'm just kind of curious so many people have come out in this press release it almost seems to be a knee-jerk reaction that they've given their support for this. Why do you think so many people have just gone on board without considering the whole nuances of what's going on here, if we're considering, the threat of global climate change, which could destroy the species, and we're just concerned about a couple of dollars in taxes? Why is it happening?
I don't think that's a fair question for me to try to answer. I do believe that it's very difficult to accept the downside of climate change and how it might really change the way we all have to live. It's a very, very difficult thing to face up to. And it's much easier to just look at the traditional concerns. And this is one of those cases where those two things, the traditional way of doing things and the bleak future that may be out there, come up against each other. So I'm not surprised that many people just sign on to the jobs and taxes thing, because that's the old way of looking at things. It's the easy way of looking at things. I'm hoping that there will be a certain number of people in our community who think beyond that and look at the big picture. But I don't think it's a fair question for you to ask me.
Okay. Well, I appreciate your thoughts on that anyway. So I'm kind of ready to finish up here, and
good.
I think it's been a really great conversation, and I really would like to thank you for taking the time to speak to me. Do you have anything else that you would like to add to this?
Not on this subject, but Chris, I'm very glad you're giving so much of your time to do this.
Thank you.
Thank you.